Boy, I love sports. And why wouldn't I? Aside from just the sheer thrill of competition, there is so much aesthetic beauty to be found in sports. I, for one, would argue that this Michael Jordan layup is as beautiful as any painting in the Louvre. Would I lose that argument? Probably. But I would damn well have it. As well as aesthetics, athleticism, and competition, sports also contain storylines, narratives, cliches, characters. Hell, a good Ashes or World Series is downright Shakespearean. But despite all of this, there's a large section of apparent intellectuals who mock both sports and the idea of thinking about sports seriously. This mindset is particularly common on the left. Now, does it stem from some childhood slight or from some cliche 1980s nerds versus jocks vibe? Perhaps. I don't super care why this attitude is a thing. I care about helping to correct this attitude. This video was inspired by a Peter Coffin tweet. A sports podcast called Pardon My Take congratulated Bernie Sanders on the job he did on Joe Rogan's podcast and invited him onto theirs to talk about similar things. Now, this podcast has 635,000 Twitter followers, but a lot of the reactions from people, supposedly on the progressive side of politics, was to mock the idea, as pointed out here by Peter. The idea that people's patron saint, Bernie Sanders, would ever deign to go on a podcast about mere sports. And that's why he went on the show hosted by a DMT enthusiast instead. See, there's an aura of smugness when it comes to the left discussing sports. Sports are seen as an interest for those of a lesser intellect, those with brawn, not brains. And while our world is burning, both figuratively and sometimes literally, why should we even think about sports? Well, if this is going to be the attitude of so many on the left, should we be shocked that the creator of Barstool Sports turns out to be a total anti-union chud? Should we gasp at the majority of NFL fans loathing Colin Kaepernick taking a knee? Can we even be mad at the astonishing influence the US military has over different sports? Leftist thinkers abandoned sports long before sports fans abandoned them. I am, of course, being slightly hyperbolic. There are some progressive people and organizations that discuss sports and politics. For instance, the writer Dave Zorin wrote a monthly column called Louder Than a Bomb in Slam Magazine. This column was all about the intersection of politics and basketball, and it was a huge influence on me growing up. It's the first thing that got me thinking about the broader implications of sports and politics. But for the most part, when we discuss vehicles for analyzing and advancing leftist causes, we don't think about or analyze sports in the same way we think about the arts or politics, and we absolutely should. So that's what I'm hoping to do with this series. Consider this video a primer on why you should care about sports, whereas other videos will be deeper dives into specific topics. I plan to talk about the following intersections, and if any of them are of particular interest to you, please let me know in the comments. Sports and class. Sports have so much to say about class in the Western world. Consider for just a moment the private golf course. The sport of golf is the basis for this club to exist, but the private club has instead acted as a vanguard for those with power and privilege to act. Why do you think Trump owns so many of them and takes his meetings there? The private golf club is a symbol far broader than the game of golf itself. It has also helped golf become a game that is associated with the wealthy. Similarly, how certain sports are played signify different levels of class in many people's mind. There is a difference in how we perceive of basketball played on New York street courts versus an organized competition in small town Indiana. With that knowledge, we also need to think about how those street courts have been commodified by companies like And1 and Sprite. Then there are other sports which require significant investments to even play. Sports which the upper and middle class, such as it is, have an inbuilt advantage for. For instance, when my girlfriend and I were in Salzburg last year, we got to talking to a friendly local. He told us about some of the nearby areas in the Alps, which had become summer homes for the rich, and how that, combined with how expensive proper skiing equipment was, meant it was more difficult for younger kids to get into skiing. This saddened him, as, in his own words, every Austrian should be able to ski. Which brings me to my next point. Sports and nationalism. Sports can play a huge role in the formation and understanding of a national identity. So, I love cricket. Every year, I go to the first day of the Adelaide Test match to watch Australia play whichever visiting nation is here. And every year I walk into the Oval surrounded by the same wave of green and gold, Southern Cross tattoos, and Australian flags. If there wasn't a sport involved, you would think we were part of a nationalist rally. This is because there is something innately Australian about being passionate about our cricket team. It has immense meaning to so many people in this country, which is why when there was a cheating scandal a year and a half ago, it prompted a response from every corner of the country. It also crushed my very last vestige of innocence. At the same time, cricket is really important to the national identities of countries in the Caribbean, as well as India and Pakistan. Did you know that India and Pakistan haven't played a test match against each other since 2007? Which is cause there's some stuff going on over there. When these two teams do play, there is understandably extreme reactions on both sides. Here we can also view cricket through the lens of post-colonialism. It was a game invented by the British, which is now primarily played in former British colonies. In the same way, remember the last FIFA World Cup? The cry of the English during their unsuccessful bid was,
"It's coming home."
The implication there being that England, as the place where soccer was born, is the true home of the sport. That is stone-cold nationalism, expressed through sport, a sort of reaction against post-colonialism. The idea being expressed here is that while soccer belongs to the world, as it's literally nicknamed the World Game, it still belongs to England, sports and race. As you might imagine, this is a big one. You know the story behind Invictus,
the South African
rugby team post-apartheid coming together with Matt Damon leading the charge. Well, before that, there was a worldwide picket line against touring or hosting South Africa in sports as part of the wider protest against apartheid. Some nations, to our disgrace, broke this picket line, but those who didn't could be proud of standing against it. Conversely, we can look at the way black athletes have been treated throughout history. Bill Russell is arguably the most winning athlete in American history, a man who has more championship rings than Michael Jordan and LeBron James combined. He dominated the NBA during the 1960s. Despite this, living in Boston, the racist underarm of America's Northeast, Russell was treated atrociously by white Bostonians. In a city that he brought 11 championship banners to, mind you. Fun fact, the FBI had an open file on him during his playing days, and we would be naive to assume they don't do the same thing with current black athletes. Especially considering we now know they believe Black Lives Matter to be a black identity extremist group. Sports and workers' rights. Professional athletes, believe it or not, are workers. Sometimes multi-millionaire workers, but more often not. And these workers almost never own the means of production. So there are people profiting off their labor, sometimes by literal billions of dollars. We should be talking about player-owned and run leagues, where billionaire consortiums don't have complete control over professional teams, especially when so often the cheapness of these owners leads to a poorer product being played at a greater price. Another interesting fact to consider is that some of the most public strikes in world history have been by athletes. Can we imagine some of those in the future? Conversely, we need to consider lockouts, which are the opposite of a strike, when the owners of the league decide to shut it down. Usually this comes in the form of them not renewing the agreement they have with the athletes and closing down the league. Nevertheless, these lockouts are often perceived in the media and then in the public as greedy players who already earn millions, demanding more. All the while, the billionaire owners, who typically profit off the stadium as well, are free to grab as much money as they can. Even when the city plays for the stadium. It's so insane. Sports and gender. This is an obvious one. Look at how the media and conservatives discuss Megan Rapinoe, a woman who dared open her mouth about politics, and the most cursed subject of all.
Equal pay.
Hell, just by saying that, I'm probably gonna get some fucking comments about it. More than that though, there are fascinating signifiers to look at in women's sports. Consider the letter W when affixed to famous sports leagues, like the NBA in America or the AFL in Australia. These signify that these are women's sports. We call them the WNBA and the AFLW. Why? It's the National Basketball Association for men, but the Women's National Basketball Association for women. In this way, women's sports is treated as the other, not the norm. People will argue that the men's leagues came first, and they shouldn't have to change their names to the MNBA or the AFL-M, which I agree with. My question is, why do women's leagues actually need different names? Would you have been confused if I told you about Erin Phillips and said she's played in both the NBA and the AFL? Would you be confused that this woman has played in both men's leagues? Or would you put it together that she plays in the women's leagues, especially since I'm using the pronoun she so often? We could just refer to them both as the NBA, and then refer to them as men's and women's in those rare cases when it's needed. But we don't, and that's really interesting to me. Then there is, of course, trans rights. Sports are used to attack trans people disgustingly often. You've probably seen the clips of Fox News anchors frothing at the mouth over trans teens trying to race against, you know, other teens of their gender. What you might not know is how they bend and flex the narrative to fit their view, to inspire more transphobia in the world. That's beyond important to talk about now. Sports and health. Why exactly are performance-enhancing drugs outlawed in sports? Surely we want our athletes to perform at the highest level, especially when so many of these PEDs are about allowing them to come back stronger after an injury. But within that discussion then comes so many more about responsible medicine, patient consent, and what is and isn't safe. Then of course there are also non-performance enhancing drugs. Who gives a damn if an athlete wants to smoke weed in their downtime? I don't think it's going to positively affect their game on the court. So why are professional leagues all around the world allowed to drug test and suspend athletes for recreational drugs? There's also the issue of head trauma in sports. I recently saw an article suggesting that contact sports will be phased out within a generation due to what we now know about concussions. Which, God, what a stupid take. It wasn't phrased as a question, as should they be banned within the next generation? It was a statement that they will be phased out. And that's not gonna happen. There is too much tradition and community tied up to the different codes of football, from America to Ireland to Australia and in between, to ever stop these contact sports, let alone in one generation. And that's without talking about the massive amounts of money involved in each of them. Billion-dollar companies won't just let themselves disappear over something as small as the health and safety of their workers. That much we know. Sports and the government. How much should sports be publicly funded? Completely? Not at all? Here in Australia, we have something called the Australian Institute for Sports. This is a government-funded institution that trains and houses athletes in Australia to prepare them for events like the Commonwealth Games and the Olympic Games. It was founded after the 1976 Olympics, when the Aussies failed to get a gold medal for the first time since 1936, much to our national shame. Is the $314 million that their governing body got last year in federal funding an extravagance we can't afford? Or is the excellent job the AIS does in funding female athletes, who are so often ignored by capitalism, enough to balance that out? Or is it maybe just the fact that we spent $2 billion last year on fighter jets that don't work enough to make you think that maybe the AIS isn't the problem? I'm okay. I just got sidetracked a bit there. Sports and... you get the idea. The effects that sports have on society are massive. And the implication of politics on sports are equally as massive. If the left is to actually reach people, maybe we should stop dismissing something so important to so many people. And that's what I'm hoping to do with this video series. If you've got any ideas or feedback, jump into the comments and let me know. I read all of them. And if these ideas are interesting to you, consider subscribing and or sharing this video with others who might enjoy it. I'm hoping to have the first video in this series up sometime in September. In the meantime, you can find all of my various hot takes and dumb jokes on my Twitter, @HardcoreLime. Thanks for watching.